Hello everybody, my name is Luis de Pablo. I am working in Thales Alenia Space, Spain. And this talk is about the testing we perform along with Thales Alenia Space France and TRAT on Gallium Arsenide devices for an ESA contract. This test was performed in a campaign in the last November. So, the radiation sensitivity of the gallium arsenide components is not so well understood as other technologies like silicon or silicon germanium. Traditional radiation hardness policy consisted in a good derating in DC bias conditions to ensure operation inside a known or unexpected safe operating area in DC conditions. However, we have seen destructive single event effects on some MESFET devices and the nominal DC bias and RF signals and conditions which were compliant with the standard derating requirements. Results indicate that radiation susceptibility depends on DC bias condition but increase with the level of RF applied to the device. However, analysis of the different manufacturer data sheets and spec and design rules manuals so that only DC absolute and maximum ratings are provided. Also, all the derating rules are given in DC ratings only. So the ECSS QST 3011, GPL, MIL-HTBK, and so on only requires derating on DC conditions. The question arising are radiation tests under DC sufficient? And if RF is needed, what RF signals? Do we need to test other technologies than power MESFET, like HEMT, pHEMT devices, and so on? Do we need to test per device, per lot, per function, per technology process? What test vehicles are we going to use? The MMIC, the technology characterization vehicle, the dynamic evaluation circuit, and how we to modify or to correct the derating rules? So under this contract, Thales Alenia Space selected several European technologies like the OMIC DO1PH pHEMT, the OMIC EDO2AH pHEMT, the UMS PPH 25X pHEMT, the UMS HPO7 MESFETs, and some non-European ones like Mitsubishi High Power MESFET, Sumitomo 7 Series MESFET, and Sumitomo Low Noise pHEMT. In order to test these devices under DC and DC plus RF signals, trying to achieve worst case conditions. These are the test vehicles used for the testing. For the OMIC EDO2AH, we use a TCV developed by Thales Alenia Space with a DAC amplifier inside. For Mitsubishi high power gallium arsenide MESFET, we use the MGF 2430S device. For the Sumitomo high power gallium arsenide, we use the FLL 120MK, which is a high power transistor, as well as the MGF 2430. And for the Sumitomo pHEMT, we use the FHX 35LR low noise transistor. You see here the devices as received and one deleted by us or by the manufacturer and the die. Also we have UMS PPH 25X. We use a TCV developed by Thales Alenia Space with the DAC amplifier. For the OMIC DO1PH we use a TCV as well, and for the UMS HPO7 we use a TCV. Here we have the test bench overview. Inside the same board, we have several devices. We have one device, reference device, and several device under test. So we have the source meter and the power sensor and the input and the output, and we have a PC with lab view. So these are the devices in the board. During the radiation campaigns in UCL cyclotron. So the irradiation campaign was performed at the heavy ion cyclotron facility at the University of Lugan-la-Neuf in Belgium on November of the last year. The ion we used was the xenon 124 with an energy of 995 megaelectron volts, which is the highest lead value available in the cotton number 2 at UCL, the facility. The lead is 62.5 megaelectron volts per square centimeter and milligram. In silicon, around 44.3 in gallium arsenide. The penetration range is around 73.1 microns in silicon, and for gallium arsenide is estimated to 49. This penetration range is enough for a sensitive thickness estimated to less than 20 microns, including passivation, contact thickness, and the gallium arsenide uniform and doped channel, which is typically less than 200. The fluence started in 10 to 6, and we go up to 10 to 7 ions per square centimeter. It was orthogonal, we do not apply any tilting, and we applied 7 to 12 runs per device, 7 to 10 minutes per run. The sample size were 3 devices under test for irradiation, plus 1 reference unit, and plus 1 attrition in the same board, not used, but in case of needed is in the board, and another attrition outside the board, outside the sample. The electrical measurements performed before and after irradiation were the output characteristics, the IDS versus BDS and BGS, the Schottky characteristics, IDS versus BGS, and during the world radiation, we performed a continuous monitoring in input and output power, in drain and gate currents, and in the temperature of the case of the components. So the first device we tested was Mitsubishi MGF2430S power transistor. We applied 2 conditions in DC and 1 condition in DC plus RF. The condition in DC are more or less maximum ratings. For the DC plus RF, we apply a compression level of 6 dB and input power of 25 dBm. The measurements performed were IDS versus BDS and BDS, and IDS versus BDS, and we performed monitoring of input-output power, temperature, and drain gate current. So we see that we have a reference device, which of course passed the test, and these are the units 2, 3, and 4, which were submitted to step 1.1 and 1.2, in DC bias and step 2 in DC plus RF, and all of them pass the test successfully. We see here the electrical measurements before and after test. Before is in blue and after is in pink. We see almost no difference in any, and the difference is explained by the heating of the component inside the chamber, because it's in vacuum, and it's, we monitor the temperature, and the component tested after the test was hotter than before the test, and this explains these slight differences in the Schottky parameters. So the conclusion is that this technology is not sensitive to heavy ions up to a lead of 62.5 megaelectron volts per square centimeter and milligram. For the Sumitomo technology FHX35LR low noise transistor, the conditions were more or less similar. So we apply a compression level of 6 dB in DC plus RF, and in DC conditions according to the maximum ratings of the spec. So the component pass in all conditions, in DC and in DC plus RF. The the comparison of the electrical measurements before and after is that there are absolutely no difference, and is some slight differences attributed to the test setup. So this technology is concluded as not sensitive to heavy ions up to a lead of 62.5. For the Sumitomo FLL 120, same conditions and same results. So the conclusion is that comparing electricals before and after, there are again a difference due to the heating of the device. And the conclusion is that the device is not sensitive to up to a lead of 62.5. For the OMIC ED02 AH technology, we use a TCB. And here we apply for the RF conditions, the same in an input power of 2.8 dBm, but a condition 2.1 with a multicarrier, with a modulation, with a subcarrier of 6 kHz and 1.5 rad index. So in the same situation, we apply for DC, and for DC detect step 2 and 2.1, and all pass the testing. Comparison before and after is show no degradation. So the conclusion is the same. So for pPH 25 peaks, we go to 6 dB. For 4 dB and 6 dB, and no effect on this technology. So it's, the conclusion is not sensitive to 62.5 megaelectrons. For the OMIC DO1PH, the conclusion is the same, going to 4 dB and 6 dB RF signals. The conclusion is that there are no differences, and it's considered not sensitive. For the HP07, technology, this device was observed as sensitivity during Californium test, lead 40, in trap building. This technology was already seen in the late 90s during heavy ion testing performed by Thales, Alenia, Space, France, and ECNES as sensitive for BGD lower than BGD maximum in dataset. So we decided to begin with heavy ions campaign with a different lead in order to define a good safe operating area and a good threshold. So we use different ions, argon with a lead of 10, nickel with a lead of 20, and krypton with a lead of 32. The RF condition were 4 and 6 dB gain compression. In the argon lead, for the ion argon lead 10, the device passed in all conditions. In ion nickel in lead 20, the device failed serial number 4 and 2 failed in condition 2.2 and 2.1. So 4 dB gain compression and 6 dB gain compression. And for krypton lead 32, we have failure even in DC condition 1.3 and 1.2. And of course we see DC plus RF 1 dB. So here you can see the burnout during the Californium testing at this stage. And what we observed just before the failure was a transient, this kind of transient in the output power, just before the failure. So this is something that we have to analyze, if there is any relation between these transients and the expected burnout produced after it. It's not the first time we have seen transients in gallium arsenide, and we believe it is a first indication that the device is sensitive to burnout. So the conclusion is that the device is sensitive to lead LED 10 for RF condition and LED 20 for DC condition. So these are the safe operating area for all these four devices. We apply in this part DC condition, in this part DC plus RF. Here we go to 62.5 megaelectron volts, and this is the safe operating area as concluded from the testing. This is the same for all the four devices. Here, the same for UMS, Anomic, PPH, and DO1, but for the UMS HP07, what we see, we go to up to this LED, and we see that in DC conditions, we fail at 20, so this is the safe operating area, and in DC plus RF, we have failure at 10. So the safe operating area is lower than this because we have failure at 10. And here the safe operating area is lower than 10 because we fail at 10. So the conclusion is that all these technologies are not sensitive except in the UMS HP07. And the final conclusion is that regarding the question, are arisen tests under DC sufficient? What we can say is that RF step stress test increasing compression level under heavy ion is highly recommended when qualifying a new gallium arsenide technology. Do we need to test other technologies than power MESFET like HEMT, pHEMT? We have seen no sensitivity on pHEMT, but cannot be extended to others without more data. Do we need to test per device, per load, per function, per technology process? The consistency of our data with previous data seems to show that testing per technology is satisfactory. And what test vehicles, the MMIC, the TCB, the DEC, we consider that the testing on TCB with DEC is okay. And this is all. Thank you very much.